Merci, cher Michel. Je vais te dire juste quelques mots en français, and then I will switch to English. Don't be afraid. But I would like to say a few words in French pour mon ami Michel, pour lui dire à quel point son expérience, son regard sur l'évolution du système multilatéral sont précieux pour nous tous. Et je dirais même sa sagesse. His wisdom is of key importance for all of us, so I would like you to applaud once again Michel Camdessus. I would like also to say hello to the new president of the World Bank. Dear David, welcome in Paris. I wanted to say hello to the acting managing director of the International Monetary Fund, dear David Lipton. Thank you for being here. I wanted, of course, to say many thanks to my friend François Villeroy de Gallo for hosting this very timely and useful conference. I would like to say hello to the commissioner. Thank you for being here, to the ambassador of Germany, and of course to the governors of central banks, our friends Hakuriko, Ignacio, François, of course, Jay, thank you for being here, Mark, thank you for being here too, and I don't want to forget my president, because I have two presidents. The first one is Emmanuel Macron, of course, and the second one is the president of the Eurogroup, Mario Centeno. Thank you for being here. Well, I'm really happy to commemorate with you this 75th anniversary of the Bretton Woods Conference. This auditorium is a bit less bucolic than the Mount Washington Hotel, where the initial conference took place in 1944. And John Maynard Keynes is no longer running our discussions, but nevertheless, I hope you enjoyed this day of exchanges here at the Banque de France on this key issue. How could we and should we reinvent the multilateral order? The first question, I think, is to look at the past and have a clear assessment of the lessons that we should draw from Bretton Woods, which for me has been really a key success for the multilateral order and especially for the Western countries. And then, in a time of great political, financial, trade instability, how should we rebuild a more efficient and fair multilateral order? This is, for me, the key question. But first of all, I would like to insist on the fact that for us, the Bretton Woods order has been a tremendous success. It paved the way for decades of prosperity and stability for Western world nations and for the whole world at large. It had brought us more trade, more growth, more jobs, and it has helped to reduce poverty worldwide. And in that sense, it has been really a huge success. It has also proved efficient in ensuring financial stability, and I want to recall how important financial stability is for all the consumers, all the savers, and all the citizens. But not only financial stability, political stability as well. The Bretton Woods order was a critical instrument of cohesion and unity for the Western world against the Soviet Union. It demonstrated that a commitment to international cooperation, along with effective multilateral institutions, are invaluable assets. The collapse of the Soviet Union is partly due to the strong cohesion to the Western countries that the Bretton Woods order allowed. We should never forget that. We owe to Bretton Woods half a century of prosperity and political power. We owe to Bretton Woods our joint capacity to have faced together moments of economic and political turmoil throughout the second half of the 20th century. The Bretton Woods order also proved its resilience when the economic oil crisis occurred in the 70s and again during the 2008 financial crisis and its aftermath, when the IMF played a crucial role, and the IMF, of course, is one of the three pillars of the Bretton Woods order. And I really want to pay tribute to the IMF, and I'm not a candidate to the IMF, so I can pay tribute to the IMF, and especially to our common friend Christine Lagarde for the key role they played to overcome the crisis after 2008. However, today's challenges are quite different, and that's the challenges mentioned by Michel a few minutes ago. Inequalities within countries and among nations are increasing, and those inequalities are a threat to growth and a threat to stability. Natural resources are running out. Multilateral cooperation is under attack. Clearly, there is an urgent need for all of us here to find global answers to these challenges. But first of all, I think that we should recognize, in a very frank manner, that the Bretton Woods order, as it stands, has clearly reached its limits. And if we are not able to have a fair assessment of the current situation, I think that we will never be able to find the right solutions. Now the alternative we have is clear. Either we reinvent Bretton Woods, we reinvent a new multilateral order which would be more efficient and fairer, or it risks disappearing. Today, Bretton Woods is contested by the two major world powers, by the US and by China, on a different manner, of course, but the contestation comes from the two major world powers. On the one hand, the US questions multilateralism, sometimes for good reasons, sometimes for reasons that might be criticized, but they are questioning multilateralism, that's a fact. The US challenged the World Trade Organization, and I've had many discussions with my counterparts in Washington about this key question of the role of the World Trade Organization. The US use extraterritorial sanctions and are backing away on some issue from multilateral cooperation, just because they consider that bilateral relationships and sometimes sanctions are more efficient at delivering their objectives. This is a fact. Just to give you one example, which is the new investigation under the 301 section against the French digital services tax. You are all aware of this decision lastly taken by the US administration. The US are one of our closest allies, and they will remain, of course, one of our closest allies. But they are ready to use sanctions against France instead of trying to sort out an issue through discussion and cooperation. Our view is that it would be far more preferable to sort out that kind of differences through discussion and cooperation instead of opening a 301 section and envisaging the use of tariffs and sanctions. And I want to be very clear. France is a sovereign nation and will continue, of course, to decide as a sovereign nation on all taxation issues. So let's work during the G7 on an international taxation on that key question of digital taxation, because this is, for us, the best way to fix out the issue. Everybody should recognize that there is a new economic model based on the use of data and the sale of data. And we cannot have an international taxation system based on the economic model of the 20th century without taking into account the fact that huge companies are creating value through the use and the selling of data without the same level of taxation as other SMEs. And I'm deeply convinced that during this G7, we will be able to find a satisfactory international solution, and that a consensus at the level of the G7 will pave the way for a solution at the OECD level, and I have been always very clear on that, as soon as there will be an international solution for the taxation of digital activities, of course, France will withdraw its national solution. I'm not blaming the US for having doubts about the efficiency of international institutions, because we must recognize that sometimes there is a lack of decisions and a lack of efficiency. And our citizens are waiting for efficiency and decisions. And I'm speaking, we have here one of the most courageous commissioner who has been able to take some very critical decisions on many difficult issues. And I think that's exactly what the people are waiting from the international institutions and from Europe as well, to take decisions to improve their daily current life. We understand these doubts, and we share the American willingness to improve the way the WTO functions and to enhance the efficiency of both the World Bank and the IMF. We are exactly on the same line on those topics. We want the WTO, the World Bank, and the IMF, the three pillars of the Bretton Woods order, to be more efficient. But we deeply think that it is wiser to reinvent Bretton Woods rather than weaken it. We think there are better ways to defend our common interest, but to use sanctions, tariffs, and run the risk of a trade war that remains the most important threat on global growth. I know that many of my American partners share this conviction. I know I can rely on David Malpass and on Steven Mnuchin, who have always shown a willingness to find shared solutions, and I'm grateful about that. We have been working very well together, and I'm sure we will continue to do so. And I want to thank David, I want to thank Steven for their commitment and their ability to work towards compromises. On the other hand, the Bretton Woods order is also challenged by the rise of China. We must have no illusion. China's aim is to go beyond the Bretton Woods order and to build a new order. This new order has a name, the New Silk Road Initiative. For many countries, this project of the Belt and Road Initiative has a true appeal. About 40 foreign government leaders attended the second Belt and Road Initiative Forum. And several countries have already backed this initiative, even here in Europe, especially in Italy. And we are ready to recognize the interest of this Belt and Road Initiative, both economic and political point of view, provided that this initiative, first of all, is a sustainable one, and second, is based on the principle of reciprocity. China doesn't hide its ambitions. In Africa, for example, as of today, the investments of China's Development Bank exceed the World Bank's investments on the African continent by $45 billion. We should be aware of that. Chinese ambitions are also quite clear on the technological front. China intends to become the technological leader for all disruptive technologies by 2025. Emerging states, investors and companies have started to look east, and it might be only a start. Bretton Woods has defined the second half of the 20th century. Be aware that the new Silk Road Initiative might define the first part of the 21st century. Unless we are able to reinvent Bretton Woods, the new Silk Roads might become the new world order. And Chinese standards on state aid, on access to public procurements, on intellectual property could become the new global standard. Again, that's a fact. And our first responsibility as decision makers, and we have here in this room key decision makers, is to face it. And my deep conviction is that Europe has a key role to play in that new situation. The EU could and should pave the way for a new multilateral order based on rules and a level playing field. and recognizing also the need for a refoundation of capitalism. Because I also think that Bretton Woods has not been weakened only by some states' behavior. Bretton Woods is also undermined because capitalism itself is being called into question here in Europe, but also in the US by many companies, by many private companies, by banks, by financial institutions, by important CEOs questioning the capitalism and the foundations of the capitalism. A growing number of our fellow citizens are rejecting a capitalism which only seeks short-term profit, which ignores growing inequalities, and which keeps depleting natural resources. We have to build a new capitalism, a fairer one, if we want to strengthen the Bretton Woods order. And I see three main priorities. The first priority is, of course, fighting climate change. You just have to ask a question to your son or to your daughter. The answer will be always the same. I do not care about politics. I care about the global warming. I care about environmental issues. I care about the fight against climate change. And the role of a political leader is to listen to the young people instead of defending its own convictions, not listening to what people are asking for, what young people and the new generation is asking for. They want us to fight climate change. That's it. And I believe that the best lever to fight against global warming is in our hands, in your hands. You, the key financial leaders, you, the members of the G7, it's finance. The best lever to fight against global warming is finance. I mean green finance. You have the tools in your hands. You are the ones which have the tools in your hands. Not only statements, not only discussions, not only exchanges of views, but you have the power of deciding because you have the power of the finance in your hands. We need massive investments to win the battle against climate change, to help people change their habits, and to invest in green technologies such as energy storage or hydrogen technologies. We can win this battle together if we have the finance, being engaged in the fight against climate change and being a green finance. All we have to do is channel financing into the right direction. We need to redirect savings and investments towards supporting the transition to a greener economy. Sovereign wealth funds have already got the message. Only last week, President Macron gathered the six largest sovereign wealth funds to agree on the necessity to better finance the ecological transition. The biggest investment funds worldwide got the message too. Things are changing finally, and we are responsible for that. On that matter, I really want to congratulate the World Bank and David Malpass. You have considerably increased your financing in this area. Between 2021 and 2025, $200 billion will be invested to fight climate change. And I really remember, dear David, your discussion between President Emmanuel Macron and yourself when you were just appointed as the new president of the World Bank. You have taken a commitment, which is to fight against climate change and to provide the necessary funding to fight against climate change. And I want to recognize that you are fulfilling your commitment and you are sticking to your commitment. Thank you for that, dear David. The recent improvements decided in the governance of the Green Climate Fund will help speed up the adaptation of vulnerable countries to the unavoidable impacts of climate change. This is proof that multilateral institutions can make a difference. The second priority is fighting rising inequalities. We have all become more aware of the economic danger of inequalities. And for that, we have to thank Christine Lagarde and her work at the IMF. If the fight against inequality is not one of the top priorities on the international political agenda, it is partly thanks to Christine Lagarde's action at the head of the IMF. The third priority is a very tricky one, but very important one: regulating the emergence of digital giants. Great global companies have reached unprecedented capitalization amounts, 700, 800, 1,000 billion of dollars. It is more than most countries' wealth. These companies create value out of the data they have accumulated with hardly any regulation. They predict behaviors, and they can influence our behavior, including our political behavior, without us even realizing it. Some companies even want now to create alternative currencies. I would argue that these digital giants are turning into private states, states over which citizens have no control and where democracy has no place. We cannot let companies which are serving private interests gather all the attributes of sovereign states. We must act. And I'm happy to see that Steven Mnuchin has expressed exactly the same concerns as mine about Facebook's Libra project. We don't want any private company to be able to create a sovereign currency. On this 75th anniversary, I call on everyone to help rebuild a new Bretton Woods order. This new order needs to rely on a renewed commitment to multilateralism and cooperation among nations. Isolation and protectionism can only lead to less prosperity, increased tensions, and ultimately to economic or political conflicts. We should learn from history. Every time nations have been tempted to withdraw from international cooperation, it has led to major confrontations. That's exactly what we need to avoid now. We also need to be collectively consistent, as President Macron recently explained at the anniversary of the International Labour Organization. We cannot support the fight against climate change and social inequalities and at the same time support a reduction of social rights in IMF programs, or free trade agreements leading to social and environmental dumping. We cannot organize a new multilateral order around such contradictions. We need a comprehensive and global approach. When I call on everyone, I mean, of course, the three institutions of the Bretton Woods order and beyond all multilateral institutions. The World Bank must keep funding green projects and keep fighting against poverty in the most vulnerable countries. The World Bank is our first and most efficient tool to reduce inequalities within and between countries. The IMF also has a key role to play in fighting inequalities between countries and to keep ensuring stability in the financial system. It should also deepen its role in promoting the implementation of climate policies aligned with the Paris Agreement. There will be soon a new managing director for the IMF after the exceptional two terms of Christine Lagarde. It is an opportunity for all of us to rethink the mandate we want the IMF to achieve. The next review of IMF's resources will also be an opportunity to show our commitments to this institution. We need an IMF with appropriate level of resources to prepare for the next crisis. Two specific issues need to be addressed. First, the problem of public debt. We have addressed that issue on the 7th of May in Paris. We must make sure all investors abide by the same rules. The second issue is financial stability. The IMF cannot guarantee this stability alone. Eurozone members have a key role to play. They have made major progress on this issue over the last year with an agreement on the Eurozone budget, dear Mario, and DSM Bastok. As a finance minister, I'm fully determined to keep working toward a stronger, a more stable, a more resilient Eurozone. We need a strong and efficient Eurozone budget for the convergence among the different economies of the 19 members of the Eurozone, but also with a stabilization function. There is a need for a stabilization function in case of an economic crisis within the Eurozone. There is a need for a banking union, and we should build this banking union as soon as possible. And there is clearly a need for a capital market union, because we cannot regret the lack of huge economic champions in the EU without providing the necessary funding for those champions. And if we want to have access to the necessary funding, we need to build the capital market union. Finally, reforming the WTO must be one of our top priorities. Abandoning the WTO would entail a global slowing down and a global impoverishment. But let's be clear, there cannot be free trade without an arbitrator. Otherwise, it just might make right. Free trade cannot be reduced to laissez-faire, laissez-aller. It's about having high standards for everyone, which are enforced, not about social and environmental dumping. That is why it is so urgent to reform the WTO appellate body to make sure it is still operational in 2020. Finally, and it will be my last word, when I call on everyone, I also mean that we have to associate all countries to this effort. The Bretton Woods order can no longer be a club of Western nations. It has to serve global interests and not the interests of only a few states. Emerging areas such as Africa and Asia, and of course China, must be better associated and better engaged. This is the only way to rebuild Bretton Woods and the only way to address efficiency the global challenges we are now facing. Climate change, the economic and political threat of rising inequalities, or financial instability. Now, all is a matter of political will. We must decide now, at the G7 Finance Summit. We must decide next month, at the G7 Summit of the leaders in Biarritz. And we must keep moving forward in the next international meetings. I do believe in the Bretton Woods order, but if we wanted to live successfully another 75 years, we must take decisions, strong decisions, and right now. Thank you.